Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, so we are happy to have Sergey Yohanin here, and he is going to be talking about new locally decoded, new locally decodable codes and private information retrieval schemes.
Thank you. So locally decodable codes are a kind of error correcting codes. And before I go into locally decodable codes, I'll briefly define the classical.
Turn it on.
Oh, it's off.
Oh, maybe red.
It may be. It recorded, but we probably could. Is it possible to increase the volume? Great.
Oh, I see.
Okay. Wonderful.
Good. Is it better now?
Yes.
Wonderful. Yeah.
Very good. Yeah. So, and before defining locally decodable codes, I'll just state what are the classical error correcting codes. And the setup here is the following. So, I guess many people have seen it, but let's go over it again. So, there are some n-bit messages that are encoded to capital n-bit code words. Then, these capital n-bit code words are transmitted over the noisy channel. And the adversary comes up and flips some linear fraction of bits. So a linear fraction of bits gets corrupted, so the 0 gets to 1. And now the decoder receives the corrupted message. And so error correcting codes have the property that, given a corrupted message, the decoder can look at this corrupted message, do some processing, and output. So look at the corrupted code word and output the message that was sent, assuming that the number of errors in the channel was not too large. And the usual objection to the classical error correcting codes, so the common objection, is the following. That it's easy to come up with a setup where the decoder only needs to retrieve a single bit of the message. Say the decoder wants to retrieve only some ith bit of the message. But if we use classical error correcting codes, then it is the case that the decoder still needs to spend at least linear time. So the decoder needs to process the whole corrupted code word to output just a single bit. And it's easy to come up to motivate this problem. In many setups, we would want fast decoding if we want to decode just a single bit. So if we want to decode a small fraction of the data, we use some very fast algorithm. We don't want to look at the whole corrupted code word. And locally decodable codes are error correcting codes that allow us not to look at the whole corrupted code word to output a single bit. So in a locally decodable codes, we encode the message with the code word. And if the code word gets corrupted by an adversarial noise, the decoder wants to output just a single bit of the message, the decoder can look just at some small number of bits, at just a few bits of the corrupted code word, and output the bit that the decoder wanted. And the decoder will be correct with high probability. So are people OK with this setup? So locally decodable codes are codes that allow extremely efficient retrieval of bits of the message from corrupted code words. So they allow this without looking at the whole code word, but just probing some small number of, say, q bits, where q can be as small as 2. So locally decodable codes were initially, they have a natural application in data transmission. So this is the application that I have just described. However, they have also plenty of applications in computer science in the context, in complexity theory, in context of worst case to average case reductions. They are related to locally testable codes, probabilistically checkable proofs. And they have very important application in cryptography that I'll be talking about later. And so locally decodable codes have been studied for a while. It's by now quite a broad area. Many people have contributed. And the main goal of research here is to understand how large blow-up do you need, how long code words you need if you want to have some very efficient decoding. So suppose that you want to decode by just looking at 3 bits. So what is the blow-up? How long code words do you need for that? These are the type of questions that are central to this area.
Just qubits. These qubits are randomly chosen.
Yeah. So yeah, they're chosen randomly.
So
but
uniformly
in some,
at random.
So there is.
Do they depend on the bit you want to decode?
They depend on the bit that you want to decode, and they're correlated. But you use randomness when you choose them. So in most of the cases, actually, every particular bit would be uniform. But if you ask, say, for 3 bits, those 3 bits would be correlated. So of course, they cannot be independent and uniform. That would contradict the information theoretic intuition. So they are correlated, and they depend on the bit that you want. Good. So here is the summary of what people have achieved. Since these codes were introduced. So they were formally defined by Katz and Trevisan around 2000, but implicitly they appeared in earlier works. And so Katz and Trevisan showed that there are no one-query local decodable codes. And it's, again, it's very well matches the intuition. It's impossible. For two queries, there is an upper bound on the length of 2 to the n. And this is a Volcker, this is just a Hadamard code. It's very easy to come up with. There is a highly non-trivial lower bound by Kirinidis and de Wolf that says that, well, in fact, 2 to the n is essentially the best you can get. So the question about the length of optimal two-query locally codable codes is closed.
What is e exponential to the n?
This is the length of the code. So we look at the following. We work on the following.
Is big n.
Right, this is capital N. Yeah. So this is the length of the code. For three queries, the problem is still wide open. So here is the summary of lower bounds. So there has been some progress. The current record is n squared over log n. This is the lower bound on the length. It's due to David Woodruff. And it improves upon two earlier works. And for three queries, the best bound prior to my work was exponential in square root of n. And this is an upper bound by Bey, Mirishai, and Kushilevitz. So for larger number of queries, say for four queries and up, there have been several steps of improvement, but in all the cases, so the behavior would be exponential in n to some constant, where this constant depends on the number of queries. And some major people in complexity have conjectured that, in fact, this is the optimal behavior, so that we would never go beyond that. So there was a conjecture by Oded Goldreich and by William Gasark stating that for any number of queries, for any constant number of queries, the best you can get is exponential in n to the epsilon for some epsilon. So there should be, we don't know the dependence on epsilon on q, but the length of optimal LDCs should be like this. So so what I show is, so I give a very big improvement upon earlier work. So for three queries, I unconditionally construct three query local decodable codes of length exponential in n to the roughly 32.5 million. So this is, well, so compared to the previous result, it's a huge improvement. And also, I obtained some conditional results. So in these conditional results rule out the conjecture by Goldreich in particular. But they are conditional. So formally, the conjecture could be still there, but I hardly
they
believe.
They are conditional on standard kinds of.
Yeah, by standard number theoretic assumptions. So assuming that the number of Mersenne primes is infinite, so Mersenne primes are prime from 2 to the k minus 1, assuming that the number of such primes is infinite, I construct three query locally decodable codes of length exponential in n to the 1 over log n, for infinitely many values of n. So the conjecture that the number of Mersenne primes is infinite is a standard number theoretic conjecture, so people trust it. It's several hundred years old, and so most number theories that I have seen believe it, so it definitely has higher weight than more recent computer science conjectures. And also, if one is unhappy with the statement that there are codes for infinitely many values of n, there is another statement. So here we need a stronger number theoretic conjecture. There is a conjecture talking about the density of Mersenne primes. So assuming the conjecture about the density of Mersenne primes, there are three query local decodable codes of length exponential in n to the 1 over log n, where log n is to the power of 1 minus epsilon, and this works for all n. So this is the statement of my results for local decodable codes.
The right behavior is, do you have a conjecture about?
So I think it's much shorter. But I would not, I mean, I would never publish a conjecture about this anymore.
How do your constants compare to the square root of n? The constants that you have in your results, how do they compare?
How do they compare to the square root of?
For what one values of n are your results really better than
oh,
the
so for which finite n, the constructions start improving upon the earlier work. So. So I never verified it really carefully. I would think that for n around, say, 10,000, you would start getting an improvement. But of course, if you want this construction, the constant inside the exponent is very large because, well, so what is exponential? This is not 2 to the n to the, so this is 2 to the order of n to this exponent, because otherwise, well, you know, you could plug into it 2 to the 32 million and you still get out with 1 bit. Well, so you, of course you cannot do that. So the constant is large. It's not something incredible, but it's not something too small either. Yeah.
If q is a function of n, if you allow more than a constant, no?
Right. So if q is polylogarithmic, you can have a linear blow up. This is known since the early works of Babai from mid-90s. But there is a reason why one would want really q to be a small constant, 2, 3, maybe 4, but probably not something more than that. And this reason is the application to cryptography that I'll be talking about now. So if you talk about error correction, about noisy channels and so on, then it's not clear why would you make a difference between 2 and 3. But now I'll bring up the cryptographic application where you really care about 2, 3, but you don't care about q being as large as log n. So in this, the cryptographic application is the application to private information retrieval schemes. So what is, yeah?
Before we move on, quick question. So are these results applied only to binary field?
No. So the binary case is like usually encoding theory. This is somehow the, so I mean, so this is the main thing. Everything generalizes. So yeah, so in particular, these results generalize to non-binary cases. But if you would ask, does this give any major improvements? So I don't know how to get those. So the exponent will be pretty much the same. But if you want ternary code, you can get ternary code. And this applies to all earlier constructions. So there had not yet been a construction that would work specifically for some field but not the other. So here is the cryptographic application of locally decodable codes. It's private information retrieval schemes. So let's look at the following setup. There is a database, and the database for us is just a binary string of length m. And the database is stored by q non-communicating servers. So here there are two servers. So each of them has a copy of the database, and they are not allowed to communicate. Now, also, there is a user. And user holds an index, an integer between 1 and n. And the user wants to retrieve the ith bit of the database without revealing anything about the identity of this bit to the users. So this is a very natural setup. If you would be able to retrieve some databases without the revealing the identity of what you are after, you would probably prefer doing this rather than revealing what you are after. So in private information retrieval scheme is a scheme that allows this. So that allows the users to retrieve what he wants, while each server individually gets completely no information about what the user is after. And this completely no information is, this is information theoretic privacy. So there is no leakage of information, no matter how powerful computation you can perform at the server. So if you see this definition the first time, it's quite counterintuitive, and it may be surprising that such things are possible. They are possible, and in particular, there is a not very intelligent protocol of sending the whole database to the user just from a single server. But also, very intelligent things are possible here. So you can achieve very small communication complexity. If you have two servers, the best people know is Q/10 communication complexity. And I'll talk more about what people know how to achieve. So this is the problem. So we look at the question of how small communication complexity you can have, how small could be the number of bits that you exchange with the servers to ensure private retrieval of data. And I want to mention that I believe that with some more effort, these schemes may get to practice. So clearly, communication complexity is not the only problem here. So we also care about the amount of computation that the server performs. And we need to take care about this multi-server assumption that we see here. So what can we do with a single server? Or why? So what is the real-life setup where we would be ready to allow 2 or 3 servers? So there are issues here, but one of the major issues was communication complexity. And my work presents a very big step towards resolving that. So the communication complexity, as you will see, has gone down a lot with this research. So imagine that you could do search on the web without revealing what you are after. I would want to do it. So,
would kind of destroy the business model, I'm just kidding. I mean,
change.
I'm not kidding, but, but it's fine.
Right. Yeah. So, but I think that it would be good for the entity who can
sure,
do it first.
Of course.
So, So here is the progress on the communication complexity of private information in trivial schemes. So they were introduced about 12 years ago by Chor Goldreich, Kushalevitz, and Sudan, and they have shown that if you have a single server, then in fact sending the whole database is the best you can do. So the optimal schemes, so you cannot do better than linear communication if there is just a single server. For two servers, they came up with a protocol with kube-root-n communication. And over these 12 years, many people have tried to improve this. So there are a bunch of known schemes. All of them end up with this kube-root communication complexity. I mentioned two schemes by Shai and Kushalevitz and David Woodruff and myself, but there are more. So these are somehow the mostly different. There are variations. So this is the best we know. The best lower bound is 5 log n by Winder and DeWolf. So the gap is huge. There are some better lower bounds in restricted models, but. And for three servers, we have seen some progress. So initial paper achieves kube-root-n communication complexity. The later paper by, so in, it's funny that they didn't know how to make use of the third server. So for two servers and for three servers, they still had kube-root. Well, and so here we'll see that third server does help. So then it was improved by M by Inish to fifth root of n. And there was a very unexpected improvement by Bemil, Shai, Kushalevitz, and Raymond about 6 years ago. They brought the complexity down to n to the 5.25 using a highly non-trivial recursive argument. Some people didn't believe that it's correct for a while, but it is. So and this is where the thing got stuck. And again, so the same people, Goldreich and Gasser, conjectured that, well, you know, so for any constant number of servers, you will never be able to beat n to the epsilon for some epsilon. And our results, so my results are the following. So unconditionally, I prove an upper bound of n to the 1 over 32 and a half million. So the number is slightly different from the number that you have seen on the previous slide. It's the previous number plus 1. So, but both of them are quite large. So, and I can say where this number comes from. So say the previous number comes from. So this is the exponent of the largest known Mersenne primes. So again, Mersenne primes are primes from 2 to the k minus 1. It's not known whether there are infinitely many of them. The biggest known is 2 to the, so this number minus 1, minus 1. So this is the exponent of the largest known Mersenne prime. So, and people look for Mersenne primes a lot. So there is like almost an industry of search Mersenne prime search. So whenever it gets improved the next time, they improve it roughly 3 times a year. So whenever it gets improved the next time, this exponent will go down. Now there is the conditional result again. So assuming that the number of Mersenne primes is infinite for infinitely many n, I get communication complexity of n to the 1 over log log n. And assuming that the density conjecture for Mersenne primes, there is a result for all n. So this is all about stating the results. And so from now on, I go into the proof. So if there are any questions about the statements. So how do we obtain these improvements? So our techniques are completely disjoint from what people have been doing earlier. So earlier, both LDCs and PAR schemes were based on some properties of interpolation of low degree polynomials. So we don't do this at all. Instead, we do the following. So here is the outline of the proof. So I will not, of course, show all the results. I will concentrate on a much more modest goal. So I'll show how to construct three query locally decodable codes of length exponential in cube root of n. So before, the record was exponential in square root of n. And the best we can do unconditionally is having 32 million here, but they'll just head for one third. But this will cover most of the techniques that go into the actual proof. So the proof consists of five parts. So first, I define some combinatorial object. I call it regular intersecting family of sets. So this will be definition. I'll say that I have some universe, and there are some subsets in this universe, and they somehow intersect nicely. This will be just a definition. I think it's central to the approach, so I will do my best to make it very clear. And then I'll show that, so given a regular intersecting family of sets, you can construct a locally decodable code. This is an exercise, and I won't concentrate much on this. And then I'll go into constructing these regularly intersecting families of sets. So first, I'll show some construction based on linear algebra over finite fields. It will be very, I hope it will be very intuitive construction. It will give us good parameters, but not, so it will match the best known for three queries. It will be inferior to earlier constructions for three, five queries. But so it will be just an alternative construction to the earlier work. But finally, I'll show how with a clever and unexpected twist based on that construction, you can push the parameters much further down. So this is our strategy. And if there are no questions, I go into the first step. I'll define regular intersecting families of sets now. So yeah?
There's some non-uniformity in the construction, right? I mean, you have to allot some time to find the Mersenne prime itself.
Right. No. So there is no non-uniformity because so if you want an optimal code that encodes so first this only applies to conditional results. In non-conditional results, you just use the biggest known Mersenne prime, and you go with it. So there is no non-uniformity at all. In the in these conditional results, if you want to encode n-bit message, then the best primes, the best prime that you would want to use is roughly, so it's sizes log n over triple log of n, it's roughly there. So you search exhaustively and you find it and you use it. So there is no. So this is the definition of a regularly intersecting family of sets. So as you see, it has four parameters. So let's concentrate on the first three. So we'll construct regularly intersecting families with parameters Q, N, and capital N. And such regular intersecting family will be used to later construct a locally decodable code that is Q query and encodes N bits to capital N bits. So the parameters are correspond to the parameters of a locally decodable code. And this is the definition. So we always require Q to be odd. This is important for us. And so a regularly intersecting family of sets is a family of subsets of some universe of size capital N. So you see this capital N red points here. So this is our universe. And our family of sets has, for every index I between 1 and N, it has a big set Ti and R small sets, QIR. So they somehow come together. So for every index I between 1 and N, there is a big set and a family of small sets corresponding to this big set. So for set Ti, for I, there is the set Ti, which is a big set, and then there are many small sets. I have drawn one of them, but there are many small sets corresponding to this big set. And then there are some conditions on intersections. So here are the conditions. So first, we require that the big sets are really big. So the size of the big set is omega of the universe size. So each of them is a constant fraction. The small sets are all of the same size Q. And remember that Q is odd. So all small sets are of the same size. Now, the small sets corresponding to a big set always sit inside of this big set. So you see the set QIR sits inside of the set TI. And also they cover, so the small sets corresponding to a big set cover the corresponding big set uniformly. So every point in the big set is covered by the same number of small sets. So these are all conditions that are very easy to satisfy. It's only the last condition.
So in particular, it has to cover.
In particular, they have to cover. Yeah, R is non-zero, that's the only. So there are small sets, yeah.
You don't have a bound on
it? No, but he's saying that it has, in particular, it has
does
to
it cover. Does it cover or not? So is the union of all the QIRs for a given I equal to TI?
Yeah.
But the other way, they don't have to be known.
Well, otherwise, R would have to be
zero. To uniform.
Because
it's uniform. He said
well, uniformly could cover, could sort of mean that the probability of the vertex being hit is.
No, he's not talking about probabilities.
No, there are no probabilities. It's
the number of
times. Uniformly covered exactly uniformly.
Exactly.
Just covered 5 times.
Exactly.
Exactly. Yes, say 5 times or 6 times. This uniformity can be different. For say, TJ could be covered. Every point in TJ can be covered 6 times, and in TI 5 times. This won't happen. But this won't occur. This won't affect the arguments.
This Q is the same as the number of queries Q.
Exactly. Okay. So all these parameters, Q, small n, and capital N, correspond to the parameters of the resulting locally decodable code. Any questions for you? So all these conditions are very easy to satisfy so far. So there is one last condition that makes the whole game interesting. And the last condition is the following. If I take a small set corresponding to some big set, if I take a small set corresponding to the ith big set, and I look at the intersection with the jth big set, then the intersection has to be even. So this is the restriction that makes the whole game non-trivial. So if I take a small set corresponding to one big set, and I look at its intersection with the other big set, the intersection has to be even. So in our case here, so Q is 3, so the intersection can either be 0 or 2. So here we see intersection 2, this is fair. So this is the definition of a regular intersecting family of sets, and we'll use them to construct locally decodable codes. And
And these were used previously?
No, this is
your
This is my definition. Okay. So earlier all these constructions were going so completely differently. So they would say that, so we take the message, we represent it somehow by a polynomial, then we use something about polynomials. This is a combinatorial approach. It will use algebra later, but it's completely disjoint. And this is a new definition. It relates to some other notions in combinatorics, of course. Combinatorics is huge, and so there were notions that were similar. So there is a notion of Ruse-Zamiatis hypergraphs, which is syntactically close. So it's different, but so there are similarities, but I won't go into this.
Can you say again what it means to be uniformly covered?
Great. So if you have a big set, and if you have a family of small sets, a family of its small subsets, I say that a big set is uniformly covered by the small sets. If it is the case that I can take that for every point in the big set, the number of small sets that cover it is independent of the point. So no matter whether I take this point or this point, each of them is covered by the same number of small sets. So
is that number usually a finite number?
Right.
You mean finite, not scaling with?
So is R scaling with n in such a way that?
So the coverage density depends only on. So in the for the definition, it doesn't matter. In the constructions that I will present, this density of coverage will depend on the prime that is being used. So in unconditional results, the prime. It will in fact always be equal to Q. That's the it will be equal to Q.
The size is QIR, and the number of times it covers each vertex is also big R equals N.
And I have R R will be equal, so R will be equal to the size of TIs, in fact. So in fact, all TIs will be of the same size, and the size will be equal to R. But this is all. We are not talking about the properties of definition, but rather about the properties of the constructions. So the constructions will have these weird properties, but for the way I define it, it's all irrelevant. So this is the definition of a regular intersecting family of sets, and now I promise to show that, well, so how, given a regular intersecting family of sets, I would construct a locally decodable code. The previous slide was important. This slide is not that important. So the main thing here is just the theorem stating that if you give me a regular intersecting family with parameters Q, N, capital N, and R, mm-hmm. it gives a locally decodable code that is Q query and encodes N bits to capital N bits. So I even would skip it. It's essentially an exercise. So how you would convert this combinatorial object into a locally decodable code? I'll briefly state it. How can you define an error correcting code in general? So we'll be building linear error correcting codes. And to define a linear error correcting code, you can just define the linear transformation linear error correcting codes are just linear transformations on messages. So I can define this matrix, so that is called the generator matrix of the code, and then I'll define the matrix using somehow this regular intersecting family, and then I'll say that the encoding with the error correcting code is just that you take your message and you multiply by some matrix. So, and how do I define the generator matrix of the code? The code should encode n bits to capital N bits. So I define a matrix of the corresponding size. I put the elements of my universe that I have in this regular intersecting family in one-to-one correspondence with the columns of this matrix. And I define the ith row of the matrix to be the incident vector of the ith big set, to be the incident vector of the set Ti. So this is the way I define the generator matrix of my code. People okay with this?
So for every different, so this is given an RIF.
Right, given
then
an
you
RIF?
Have a generator.
Exactly. So, but also if I'm defining a locally decodable code, I need to define the code itself, so how I encode the data, I also need to define the decoding procedure, so how do I do the decoding? So, and here is my decoding algorithm, it's just these two lines. So suppose you give me a corrupted code word, and you ask me to decode the ith bit. So what would I do? So the corrupted code word is y, and you say that, well, so now decode the ith bit, so bit number I.
Don't use the small sets.
No, not
just
at all.
Care about the large sets.
Yeah. So the small sets correspond to the decoding. It's natural. We are of size Q, so they correspond.
So wait, what is the incidence? I thought it was the incidence with the small set.
No,
no.
Incidence.
No, it's just, it's some fraction, some non-zero fraction of the entries are going to be 1.
When is it 1?
They said TI.
TI contains that element of the universe.
Exactly. Oh, okay. So now how do I do the decoding? So you give me the corrupted code word Y, and you tell me, so decode now the ith bit. So I do the following. I pick, I look at the small sets. So remember that for the big set TI, there was a collection of capital R small sets corresponding to it. So I'll pick a random small set, QIR. So I'll pick one of those small sets uniformly at random, and I compute the dot product of the vector y with the incidence vector of the small set.
Wait, what was y? I'm sorry.
Oh, so y is the corrupted code word that you give me.
Oh, okay.
So y is the corrupted code word. So I pick a random small set, and I read and I'll put the XOR of the coordinates in the corrupted code word that correspond to the elements of the small set. So this is the decoding procedure. And the proof that it works is these two lines. And the game is about the parity. So then the parity. So there we were saying that small. I'll do it. So I see that people follow very well. So yeah, I'll go carefully through this proof.
Yeah.
So people are okay with the definition of the generator matrix. Good. So here is the decoding procedure again. So you give me the corrupted code word y, and you give me the index I. So you tell me, given this corrupted code word, decode the ith bit. What I do is, so I look at the small sets corresponding to the big set TI, and I pick one of them uniformly at random. And what I do next is, I can say it in the following way. So I look at the incidence vector of this small set. So the small set is just the set of subset of size Q of the universe, so I can look at its incidence vector. And I would output the dot product of the incidence vector of the small set with the corrupted code word that you gave me. And why does this work? So now let's just think about, so what are these incidence vectors? What are the dot products? So if I take a small set QIR and I take a big set TJ, and I just want to think, so what is the dot product of their incidence vectors? Right, so the dot product is 1 if and only if I is equal to j. If and only if the small sets correspond to the big set. If it doesn't, the dot product would be 0. And this property is exploited in order to ensure the decoding is correct.
So yeah, the parity is real. I mean, the fact that it intersects an odd number of times
right.
with its own stack
right.
and even number of times with every other one.
Right. Right.
So how many errors can I talk
about? So it depends on Q, but Q for us will always be constant, so it will be like 3. It depends on the size of the sets TI. So here it's hidden. I mean, so here I'm not. I mean, because it will just bring up too many parameters on the slide. But you are guaranteed that it's some constant fraction. So in the actual construction, the amount of error that is called tolerate is around 12%. So it's some reasonable number. Yeah. So for with 3 queries, they tolerate around 12% error. But the way you derive 3%.
So
in terms of non-existence results for locally decodable codes, the things are very poor. I mean, so there is nothing non-trivial known there. Because you need to, you are arguing not about the properties of the error correcting codes, but about the local decodable error correcting codes. So you need somehow to take this local decodable property into account, and it's hard to argue about. So this is the proof. So suppose that you gave me a code word which had not which was completely uncorrupted, so which is perfect. And I'll show that with probability 1 I decode correctly. And then I won't argue why somehow even if you give me a corrupted code word I'm still in a good shape. But it's just because the sets TI are large and I have this uniform coverage. This is the intuition there. So right, well, and this is based on this property of dot product. So
here you don't even need to randomly pick them.
So if there had been no error, yeah, I mean, then I could then I don't need to pick randomly. But I pick randomly to go around the error. So if there were error, then this randomness would help.
I don't see where you're using the uniformity of the coverage.
So I don't need to stick to uniformity really. But if I wouldn't have the uniformity at all, if it would be completely broken, if I would say have only one small set, or if all the small sets would be the same, they would all land in some three coordinates. Then it means that I always query these three coordinates, and these three coordinates could be corrupted. So I would be always outputting the wrong answer.
I see. So you want roughly equal probability of sampling any
right.
coordinate, and that's why you're doing.
Don't you just need lower bounds?
Right. I would be perfectly.
Well, if he's picking the cues,
I mean, you
uniformly at random, then he'll be sampling too much of certain things if they are covering much
more. So what if I had what if the cover rate would vary between 1 and 20?
That would be perfectly fine.
Yeah.
But the thing is that here I state a combinatorial problem. Combinatorial problem sounds nice if it's like a clean mathematical statement with this small number of parameters. Right. Otherwise, exactly. Yeah. So you can relax. You can relax this definition in tons of ways.
Strictly using the uniform.
Exactly. But I'm getting it through my construction. So that's why I put it into definition. You can take that previous definition, you can relax it in tons of ways, and you can get equivalence to local decodable codes. But that's, since we are proving upper bounds but not lower bounds, we are not.
The pure systems?
Uniformity itself does not immediately imply pairs, unfortunately. So in other, it's important there, and it helps, but it's not enough. Because
for which system?
Private information.
So in private information retrieval, you want somehow uniformity on the whole set.
Yes.
While we are getting uniformity only on something. So it's not enough. You need to make some more twists to do pair reductions. They are easy, but but their uniformity is helpful.
If the size of R, capital R, is large, then you can tolerate more? Is that?
No, the size of R is irrelevant as long as... to be large is the size of TIs. So remember that there are the big sets TIs. So if you want your queries to be, and the queries are uniform, if you query for the ith coordinate, your queries are uniform over the set TI. This is what you achieve by uniform coverage. And so if the set TI is large, if it's closer to the whole universe, then it's better for you. You can tolerate more error.
So R doesn't change like...
R does not affect anything, it's essentially irrelevant. So you only need uniform coverage. Whether you cover 20 times or 60 times does not have any impact on the error that you tolerate. So people okay with the reduction? So I defined the code. I defined the decoding procedure. And the correctness of the reduction is based on this parity. And I don't want to parse this line. It's a 5 minutes exercise. So from now we can forget about local decodable codes, PRs. We can just think about regular intersecting families of sets and how do we build those, because they imply local decodable codes. Those imply private information retrieval schemes. So what we want is just this combinatorial object, regular intersecting family of sets. So how do we do this? So here is the idea for the basic construction. So our universe will be a high-dimensional space over some finite field, over a prime finite field. So we'll take some prime, we'll take a high-dimensional finite space over this finite field, and we'll say that, this is our universe of points. We'll pick the big sets Ti to be unions of certain parallel hyperplanes. So I would prefer just picking hyperplanes, but this doesn't work quite well, so we take unions of parallel hyperplanes.
And why?
I'll say it. And we pick line, and pick small sets to be lines. And the intuition somehow, so the intuition for the, I think it has a good intuition behind it. So the intuition is that also lines and hyperplanes, if in nature there is something, some kind of intersections that we can understand, these are the intersections between lines and hyperplanes. So a line is either contained in a hyperplane or it intersects it in a single point. And why do we take parallel hyperplanes? Because if we want intersections to be larger than one, then we want somehow, if you have two parallel hyperplanes, then I know that my align is either contained in one of them or intersects it twice. If I have three, I know that it intersects. Then since I care about the multiplicities of intersections, so since I care about how many times I intersect rather than whether I intersect or not, I pick parallel hyperplanes. So this is the idea. So big sets will be unions of parallel hyperplanes, small sets will be lines, and we will be able to analyze intersections somehow. And as a result, we'll get a regular intersecting family with some parameters such that once I convert it into the parameters of locally decodable codes, this will be p query locally decodable codes of length exponential in n to the 1 over p minus 1.
So the number of parallel hyperplanes has to be
odd. Has to be even. Well, but I mean, for now it's not obvious, yeah, but it has to be even.
That's why the one didn't work.
Yeah. Well, it has to be even, because when I take lines that correspond to other set Ti, I want it to intersect it in the even number of, I want to intersect it, the set Tj, in an even number of coordinates. And it intersects every coset, so I want the number of cosets to be even.
The line of that thing itself, that
it's
will
lying
contain.
In
it's contained.
It.
Yeah.
Lying in it, and otherwise it's.
Okay. Yeah, exactly. Yes. Very good. Yeah.
So just to make sure that, so your, what you want is for a fixed universe size, say a universe, to build as many of these sets, the large sets,
right,
with the small sets that intersect.
For a universe, yeah, exactly. So for a fixed universe, I want to maximize the number of big sets that sit there. Yeah. And each big set is a union of parallel, will be a union of parallel hyperplanes. But there will be a few more slides on this construction, so I don't try to guess it to the whole thing. So right, and as a result, I'll get some parameters, and they imply locally decodable codes that have p queries, and the length is exponential in n to the 1 over p minus 1. So for three queries, I will get exponential and square root of n, which matches the best known prior to my work, but does not beat any records. And in fact, for, say, five queries, it will be even inferior to the earlier work. But this will be the base for the real construction. Yeah.
So you said that you of course, want the TIs to be as big as possible.
TIs, yeah, I want them.
So that you can tolerate more errors. Is it clear, well, I guess this is going to be part of your construction, how big you can make these sets of parallel hyperplanes, right?
Right.
I mean, you need to find enough of them,
right,
and you need to make them big, and so you're going to somehow use these primes to.
The primes will be used to ensure to. Well, so here the prime will not be relevant. So for the basic construction, I can use any odd prime, it will still work. So the Mersenne primes will come up in the main construction. That will be a twist on top of this thing. So here I don't need any.
Yeah, I guess you're just getting us into the 1/3 right now.
Oh no, here I enter the one. So now I'm just getting even into the 1/2. So I'm covering the basic construction, and then there will be the main construction is a twist on top of this. And it will have some of these flavors, but it will be different, so it will
can
be more clever.
Can you map this construction into what
the main
guys did with to get to the end of the map?
No,
and all
it's a different code. It's completely different code. And it exhibits some properties that these codes do not have, so it's really different. So and but clearly I cannot pick any set of hyperplanes, any set of lines. So there should be some constraint on the arrangement of lines and hyperplanes. And so, so to get this constraint, I won't state it, but so I won't try to reveal exactly what the constraint is. I need a technical lemma, and this technical lemma will yield the property that I want later. So this is just a technical statement. So let P be a prime. And let's look at a high-dimensional space over FP. So let's look at FP to the M. I claim that in that space, I can pick two N vectors, U1, UN, V1, VN, where N is as large as M choose P minus 1. And this collection of vectors would satisfy the following property. The dot products of UI, VI are 0. The dot products of UJ, VI are not 0. The very basic property. So this is just a lemma. I say that, well, so if I look at high dimensional space over FP, I can pick these many vectors with the following property. And later.
That's sort of funny. That's sort of the opposite of the usual.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So usually you would say that, yeah, but if you would say UI, VJ are, well, okay, so yeah, but this is what I'm after. And there is three-line proof of this lemma. I don't want to go into it. And this is the optimal construction. So really, you can pick this many vectors. You cannot pick more. And again, this is an exercise to verify. And I will use a pair UIVI to somehow define this big set TI and small set. So here is the actual construction. Here is the actual construction. I use this pairs UIVI with this property on the dot product to define the big sets and small sets in my universe. So let's think that say P is equal to 3. So how do I define the big set? I say that I take all x's in the space such that ui times x is either 1 or 2. And this gives me two parallel hyperplanes, 1 and 2. And if I would ask, so what is this?
I still have sort of a hard time understanding intuitively this lemma. I sort of says that for each I there are sort of, well, I only have to find one vector which is orthogonal, but then I have to find many which are sort of not parallel, but at least have a parallel component.
Okay, so let me
prove. Yeah, because your Qs are going to have to intersect all of those other parallel.
Well, I know how to use it, but I don't understand why the lemma is true.
Oh, so let me prove it just. So I remember that these are vectors in FP to the M, not in F2. So I use the fact that the field is large here.
One thing to keep in mind is that inner products don't work like you expect here.
Because of FP.
Yeah.
So let me prove it. So in fact, all my vectors will.
It's because they're just mod 2.
Right.
Oh, it's not mod 2. It's mod
right.
P.
Right.
It's mod P.
And so AB just told Christian the reason it's bothering him is because mm-hmm. he's thinking mod 2 and not mod P.
No. He's telling me.
Thinking over R.
I'm thinking of this as in a scalar product, but they're really not. They're not a distance. It's this vector of these products.
I'm not sure I understand what exactly is the confusing point, but let me just construct them. The vectors will be just zero, one vectors. So although these are vectors in FP to them, they will be just be 0, 1 for me. So I'll pick vectors. I promise to construct M choose P minus 1 of them, so these many. So I'll pick vectors ui to be incidence vectors of all possible subsets of cardinality p minus 1 of m. So vectors ui are all possible vectors of cardinality of all possible vectors of Hamming weight p minus 1 and length m. And vectors vi are their complements in the binary sense. This is the whole construction.
And that's it?
Yeah.
And now it has that property.
Right.
Great.
So you get the orthogonality.
Yeah, because every two.
You get the orthogonality except for the I.
Because the intersection of the set U of the UI and VJ.
It's not going to be complements.
Right. It will be between P minus 1 and 1.
Okay.
I mean,
I see. Okay.
This is the optimal construction. So if we could do better here, it would improve the parameters, but we cannot. So this is quite. Not very clever construction is what is the optimal what one can get here. So this is the largest collection that one can have. And here is how we convert these UIs, VIs into actually, so how we pick hyperplanes, how we pick lines. So I use vectors UIs, so a pair UI, VI would define everything about index I for me. So I will use UI to define the big set TI, and I will use VI to define the small sets, QIs. So this is the definition of the set TI. These are all x in the space such that ui times x is say 1 or 2. So here for us pc is 1 or 2. And each of these slices is a hyperplane. So these are two parallel hyperplanes.
Uh-huh. I see. So if you're headed for, if you're using p equals 3, then you have 2, then your ti's are 2 parallel hyperplanes.
And similarly, if I look at the set TJ, then it also consists of two parallel hyperplanes. Mm-hmm. And now I need to define the small sets. So the small sets corresponding to index I are lines in direction VI. How do I define them? I pick an arbitrary point in the set TI, and I go in direction VI. And the observation is that given this dot product property, I will stay in the set TI. I will stay in the same hyperplane. And if I look at the intersection with the other big set, I will intersect each of the hyperplane cosets once. So, and there are two of them, so I'll have the intersection of two. So this is the construction. So this picture captures everything. So this is why the construction works. So because the small sets are lines in the hyperplane, but not in any other hyperplane in this.
So where do you use that P as a prime?
Oh, where I have used the P as prime. So now I'm a little confused about how to answer this question. So something generalizes to rings, but not everything. So the basic construction may generalize to rings. I'm not sure that it does. The main construction, that is really the twist that gives the improvements, does not easily generalize. So yeah. So I don't see it immediately.
So you used that the FP was a field.
Yeah, especially in the main construction. I think it's used somewhere here also. At least you will clearly run into this problem when you would want to construct these vectors, right? Because this construction uses that P is prime. Because the dot product ui vj is any number between 1 and p minus 1, if you construct the vectors like this. Okay. If p would start having divisors, but you would be OK here, but then later when you use them, OK, I think that then you can run into the problem when you would argue these intersections. But so let's take this offline. I can't make a crisp answer now. So this is the basic construction. This is the picture that captures the whole story. This is the formal proof if we want to look at it. So I need to argue this, the fact that small sets are contained in big sets, and that small sets corresponding to one big set have even intersection with other big sets. So this is the algebraic proof, which the one is three lines, the other is two lines.
I showed the pictures.
Let's go further. Let's go to the main construction. So this is interesting. So that construction seems it reaches its limit. So because we cannot build any more vectors ui vi with this nice property that we used, with this nice property that is important for us, but apparently it doesn't. So we can still push. So we reach something, but we can do better. And this is the main construction. This is the unexpected part. So how do we build on the basic construction? So we still use our universe is still the high dimensional space over a prime field. We keep it the same. And we still want to use sets Ti to be unions of hyperplanes, unions of parallel hyperplanes. But now, so here is where we are brave. So instead of taking small sets to be lines, we'll take small sets to be subsets of lines. So I'll say that, so here is my prime, say it's 17. And instead of taking my small set to be the 17 points, I'll only take points number 1, 3, and 6. So in the actual, like in the best construction, the prime is 2 to the 32 million plus something, minus something. And so the lines are huge, while really my small sets are just 3 points on these lines. So I take some lines, number something, say that, so my now my small sets are these subsets of lines. So this is what is different. But clearly, if I just make this change, then the construction would fail. Because how do I argue? So it's easy to argue the intersections of lines and hyperplanes, but how do I argue the intersections of subsets of lines and hyperplanes? So we need some more cleverness. So first, we'll be very careful in choosing which subsets of hyperplanes we take. Earlier, we cared just that, which parallel cosets of hyperplanes we take. So earlier, we just were saying that, well, just take an even number of them and it will work. So here, we'll be very careful about which cosets we take. And we'll also be much more careful about choosing the vectors ui, vi. But then, so once we do all of these three relaxations, we win. So we get all what we wanted. And finally, this will give us regular intersecting families that yield locally decodable codes with all these great parameters. So in particular, we'll see cube root, length exponential in the cube root of n, but also one can get all this n to the 1 over log, exponential n to the 1 over log log n, and so on. So this is the idea. It may sound a little vague. So let's make it a little more formal. So let's look back at the basic construction. So what do we change to make it our main construction? So earlier we were saying that so our small set is a line. So we take a point R in the big set Ti, and we just take every point on the line. We take R plus lambda Vi. Now lambda will not vary in FP. Lambda will vary in S1. So we'll only take points. We'll only take a subset of points on the line rather than the whole line.
S1 will be the same for all lines.
The set will be the same for all lines. For all lines, yeah.
And R varies over all the points in Ti?
R varies over all points in Ti. In particular, if you take the line, then this is how you get that every point on the in the set Ti is covered the same number of times that is Q. And Q now is the size of S1. Because you start at every point on the line, and so every point on the line is covered by is covered S1 times. So, right. So, and the sets Ti, now earlier I said that, well, I'll take all the hyperplanes except just a single one, and I don't care which one I throw away. I only care that they're all the cosets of a hyperplane except a single coset, and I don't care which one I throw away. So here I'll be again very careful. I say that, well, I take the cosets of some hyperplane, but I'll be careful in choosing which cosets I take. So I'll, for every ui, I will take all x's such that ui times x lands in some set as 0.
And so you want that set as 0 to be big.
I want it to be big. I want it to be big. That's true. But I'll be able to guarantee that it's that it will be big. And also, in terms of how I choose these vectors ui and vi. So earlier I was saying that ui vi is 0, ui vj is non-zero. Now I'll say that uj vi and lands in some set s. So
and s will be sort of order 3, where sp becomes huge.
No, s will be, so s1 will be of size 3, because I want three queries. S1 will be of size 3. S will be logarithmic in the prime that I use. So S will be growing.
So wait, so why are you doing this? You only want certain angles. Why do you only want certain angles?
Because I finally want a very counterintuitive statement. I want to say that I take this union of hyperplane cosets, and I take any line that goes in direction vi, and I care not about the how many times this line intersects the hyperplanes. I care about how many times a certain subset, a very weird subset of this line, intersects the union of these hyperplanes. And then I start caring about, and here I have to care about the angles much more. I have to be much more careful about the angles. This is the intuition. Because it's easy to argue about line about how line intersects a hyperplane. It's much harder to argue about how a subset of line intersects a hyperplane.
So for example, if the subset is very sparse, you would want a shallow angle.
Exactly. Yeah, but this is the deals. Yeah.
Okay.
But this one's zero. So this is the relaxation, and then so now what do we want? So here you can trust me that it works. But so there is some way we can impose some requirement on S as 0 and S 1 simultaneously, such that once this requirement is satisfied. We would be guaranteed that the intersections are nice, that the intersections are as we wanted them to be, and this will be some clever restriction on some relation between these sets.
I'm trying to think about how this works, and I'm okay. So, on the basis, I understood what Christian just said, which I'm sure is like the zero order intuition on it, but. If R is going to be small, if you're just choosing a few, but you understood it and I did. I'm just saying, I know his constructions are complicated. So you just choose a few points and you want shallow angles. Now, shallow angles means, though, that your sets Ti and Tj are going to be kind of close to each other.
Oh, these are the angles. So these are the dot products between Ui. And uj and vi, while the set tj is not defined by vj, it's defined by uj.
Oh, you're right. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any more questions? So now I'll show some consistency requirement on s is 0 and s1, such that once this consistency requirement is satisfied, the intersections are right. So then if we would have time, I would argue this formally why this is the right requirement, but now I'll just state it. So, and we would want this requirement to be satisfied. On the other hand, we would want to have many pairs UI and VI, because remember that every pair UI VI gives us some extra bit that we can encode. Mm-hmm. So, and this depends on the set S. And even just this question is non-trivial. So for which sets S, it is the case that I can pick many UIs, VIs that would satisfy this constraint. So if S is something, can I build it? It's not an obvious thing either. So now I'll state both of these constraints, so what they are, and and then we'll move on. So here is the constraint on the sets S0 and S1 that ensures that once you plug in the sets in the construction in the previous slides, the intersections work out. So here is the constraint. So S should be a subset of FP star. This is natural, right? And A0 and S1 should be subsets of FP. So here is what we want. A0 should be non-empty. This is obvious because we want to pick at least one hyperplane coset. The size of S1 should be equal to Q because this is our query complexity, and we insist that it's odd. And this is the constraint that is important. So here is the way to state it. I look at the set S0, and I look at the set S1. And I insist on the following. Whenever I make an affine transformation of the set S1, where the multiplication comes from the set S, and the additive shift is unconstrained. So whenever I make such an affine transformation of the set S1, it should have even intersection with the set S0. So I don't think that one can, I think it's hard to develop any intuition immediately, at least, why this is the right constraint. And somehow even to grasp this notion well, but this is really the constraint that we are after. So we want sets S0, S, and S1 to be such that whenever I act by an element of S on the set S1 and I make an arbitrary cyclic shift of the set S1, it still has an even intersection with the set S0. So this is my constraint. And if I find the triple S S0 and S1 that satisfies these properties, I say that the set S is Q algebraically nice. So this is my definition. And really, so this property was implicitly used in the basic construction. There we used the fact that the set S, which is FP star, is P algebraically nice. And we can argue, we can easily come up with sets S0 and S1 showing why this is like that. But, I have time till 12, right? Do I? Or I should stop earlier?
Yeah, we've been asking you a lot of questions. So I don't know. Try to wrap up in another 10 minutes.
Good. Yeah, I'll be done.
Okay.
You also started with it. Yeah. So that was algebraic niceness, and that was the restriction on the consistency of the sets S0 and S1. There is another constraint saying that we want to have many vectors UI and VI. And this is just what I said, right? So we say that the set S is T combinatorially nice if we can design these many M to the T vectors U and V such that the products UI VI are 0 and the products UJ VI are in S. And again, so in the basic construction, we used combinatorial niceness implicitly. So the basic construction used the fact that the set FP star is P minus 1 combinatorially nice. So in there, we proved it is the technical lemma. Right? So these are two notions that we need. We'll get back. Let me state the theorem. Somehow the main theorem and the main construction is that once if you find a set that is T combinatorially nice and Q algebraically nice, then you can construct certain regular intersecting family, and it gives you a local decodable code which is Q query and that has length which is exponential in n to the 1 over t. So this is the final output in terms of local decodable codes. Now it all reduces to these questions about subsets of FP and so what properties they can exhibit. This is our main construction, right? So this is our universe. This is the high-dimensional space over a finite field. The sets Ti are hyperplane cosets, but we don't take all cosets. We take only those that land in a zero. And the small sets are lines, but are subsets of lines defined by S1. This is this pictorially. So P is 5, but I don't take 4 hyperplane cosets. I take only 3. So Ti consists of 3 hyperplane cosets, Tj consists of 3 hyperplane cosets, and on the lines I don't take now all points, I take only some points, and still I ensure the correctness of intersections. So we are very close to the end. So and So this is the formal proof showing why somehow why these properties about why this combinatorial niceness and algebraic niceness, why the way we define them is the right way to define them, really. So we only, I mean, the only non-trivial thing is to show how this algebraic niceness constraint, that look weird property about the intersections of the set as zero and the affine shifts and the affine transformations of the set as one, why this is somehow the right property that we want to ensure the right intersection. So this is the formal proof. And this is these four lines. So this shows that really, so this is the property that arises when we talk about intersections. Because, so what is the intersection of the set Tj with the set Qir? So this is the number of lambda in S1 such that the, so, well, so such that, so when is the when does the point land in Tj? This is when Uj times this point is in S0. So, and what are the points in Qir? These are the points of the form R plus lambda Vi, where lambda varies in S1. So now I use just the linearity of the dot product and rewrite it like this. But then this is exactly, so the question about the size of the set is exactly the question about the intersection of the set S0 plus a certain transformation of the set S1, where the transformation can be rewritten in this form. So these four lines are the technical proof of why somehow algebraic niceness, the way I define it, is the right property that we are after. And this is the whole story. So after it, it's just a question of we only need to argue that there are subsets that exhibit this combinatorial niceness and algebraic niceness simultaneously. And the first time it happens non-trivially is p equals 7, where you could take the subset 1 to 4. And this happens to be a subset that is 3 algebraically nice and 3 combinatorially nice. So you need to prove, of course, both of these properties. It's fairly easy to prove combinatorial niceness, and it's non-trivial to argue algebraic niceness. But so this is the first time it happens non-trivially, and this gives the 3 query locally decodable codes of length exponential and cube root of m. And if you want to go further, then the pattern is the following. So you can pick p to be a Mersenne prime, so you prime it from 2 to the k minus 1. And you can pick the set S to be the set generated by 2. So a multiplicative group generated by 2 in FP star. So it will be 1, 2, 4, 8, and so on.
And see where the 2 to the k minus 1 comes in.
Why are you picking P's to be Mersenne primes as opposed to?
Right. So because I did not show how I argue about combinatorial and algebraic niceness, right? So combinatorial niceness I understand quite well, and there I don't need any special structure on primes. So I can say that any multiplicative group is essentially is combinatorial. So any multiplicative subgroup of FP star is combinatorially very nice for any prime. But when I argue about algebraic niceness, I start caring about which primes I use. And I know how to prove that for Mersenne primes, it happens to be that that the subgroup generated by 2, so exactly this set, so the subgroup generated, the multiplicative subgroup generated by 2 is 3 algebraically nice for Mersenne primes. So I can only prove this narrow statement.
Do you know of any other cases that have that property of the primes?
Yeah, so one can relax, of course, the condition on the Mersenne primes and say that, so for some more general class of primes would work, so it does not need to be Mersenne, but this relaxation somehow does not seem to be sufficiently strong to yield anything interesting. So first, people have invested a lot of effort into search for Mersenne primes, and they have found this huge Mersenne prime, and this is the biggest explicit prime known to the humanity at all, so there isn't much reason to relax it if you don't want to make, to get an unconditional result if your approach would end up with some dependence on an explicit prime, probably depending on the biggest Mersenne prime is as good as you can get. So could you relax it stronger as to be able to prove that there are infinitely many primes of certain shape? So it seems to be out of reach. There is a way to state it, but.
So you looked into, I don't know, some of these with tau proofs or something.
I talked to 4 big number theorists and I asked them, so there is the number theory question that arises there. So So in the question from, are there infinitely many primes of with some property? So are there infinitely many Mersenne primes? This is the way I ask it here. But you can relax it, and you can not talk about Mersenne primes, but some more general class. But eventually you want a statement that there are infinitely many primes of this type. And yeah, so I relax it as much as I could, and I ask this question from a number of people. So it seems to be out of reach. Some people were very big, so I would hope they should know. But this is it, and we are getting to conclusion. So the summary. So we developed a novel approach for constructing local decodable codes and private information retrieval schemes. So it's completely disjoint from people we were doing earlier. We obtained vast improvements upon what was known, and so under some number theoretic conjectures, we broke the major conjectures that were in this area. And so there are two goals, of course, remaining. So one is to understand the limits of the approach that is developed here. It's not completely clear that really you cannot get any further improvements using these techniques. Although doesn't seem easy either. And of course, there is another question of determining the optimal parameters of LDCs and PIRs. So there is still a huge gap to the lower bounds, although we got an improvement. Yeah.
Do you have any upper bounds?
So these are the upper bounds.
The combinatorial problem said that you want to, given a fixed universe, you want to squeeze as many sets. Do you have an upper bound or not?
So any impossibility result? No.
I mean, not about log, just about the combinatorial problem.
No, not at all. And moreover, so it's related to there is a notion of Ruge-Zamiredi graphs. So these are the things that have been studied. And this combinatorial object is again, so it's syntactically similar to Ruge-Zamiredi hypergraphs. These, as far as I understand, have been studied less. But even for Ruge-Zamiredi graphs that have been studied, so I think that the situation with impossibility results is very poor. So proving that something is not possible somehow. So I don't know of any non-impossibility results for this combinatorial question. And I think that this construction is still far from optimal. Yep.
I'm very intrigued by the Mersenne prime tie-in, but do you have any sort of gut feeling or sense in your exploration of how many other primes seem to have this property? Is it common? Is it very rare?
It's somewhat rare. So I can state the mathematical property that is important there. So it's the following. You want to come up with a pair of primes P and Q such that such that when you look at the algebraically closed field FQ closure, and you look at the factorization of the polynomial x to the p minus 1 in that field, so the roots of this polynomial would form a sub. Let's say it in the following way. So you want to come up with two primes p and q such that when you look at the factorization of the polynomial, when you look at the splitting field of the polynomial x to the p minus 1, in the algebraic closure of FQ. So there is some splitting field, it will sit somewhere, so this polynomial will split in a certain extension of FQ. So you want, and its roots will form a subgroup of that field. So you want the subgroup to be as large as possible in comparison to the splitting field. So you want the property that once this polynomial x to the p minus 1 splits, its roots form a large fraction of its splitting field. So this is the property that you want.
I guess it's some work to try to construct this, but you could, in theory, do a search of the first million primes and see how many of them have this property.
Right, but Mersenne primes are somehow perfect in this sense, because for Mersenne primes you have the property that the splitting field, so the splitting field of the polynomial consists only of its roots and zero. So Mersenne primes are as good as it gets. We don't need primes that are so good for this construction to work. Right.
And it's not defined what it means to be, right? You should only be off by.
But
you're looking for a certain property, and it's interesting to know just what the density of primes of this property is.
Right. Well, but Mersenne primes, I mean, so looking for the first million, I mean, Mersenne primes, it's like 2 to the 32 million. So right.
There aren't many Mersenne primes in that set.
Yeah.
There are a lot of primes in that set. So.
Yeah, so it depends on how nice, again. Depends on what density you want. So if you want perfect density, you end up with Mersenne primes. If you end up with density that gives something, I'm not able to say more here. Yeah.
So I have a very rough question. So it seems like you're dealing with arrows in the string, right? So do you even to cancel them out? So have you ever think about if I know the arrow precision, say these are erasures, right?
So
many applications, right? You can think of, you know the position of these things.
Right. So can you do locally?
Does it make your problem more easier? Or
yeah, so in general, error correcting codes, of course, erasures are always much easier than errors. So have people looked at local decodable codes from erasures? So I don't see the answer immediately. Maybe that the problem gets easy. So for locally codable codes, also say people look at adversarial noise. If you would ask about non-adversarial but random noise, the problem gets very easy immediately. So does it get immediately very easy for erasures? I don't see. If it doesn't, yeah, then it's definitely an interesting question. Yeah, I had never seen such papers, but maybe it's because it gets easy. I don't know.